Welcome to today's video. Today's video, we're going to be going into the various charge points that you can get available, the price they cost, the advantages what they have. Some require earth rods, some don't, and the basic install price. So the basic install price, what we're going to be displaying today, is if it includes one earth rod. If the charge point doesn't need an earth rod, we will mention it in the video. This unit here is the Emon EVSE. Out of all these units, if you are a geek, love figures, then this is probably the most data-driven unit.
Yeah, this is the one for you. So if you're into your Raspberry Pi and programming and all that sort of stuff, that's, to be honest, way beyond me technically, this is a brilliant unit. Got the solar monitoring, it can do charge scheduling, it links with app. Lynn and the team here do a fantastic job. It's kind of more niche market stuff, but they're doing other things like the open vehicles monitor system, so you can have better apps for your cars and things. It's definitely worth checking out, and it's a very popular unit. The people that do have this absolutely love it.
This unit is available in the solar diversion system as well.
Yes.
Earth rods required?
Yes, okay. But they are working on a solution, so it won't need
untethered
them.
Only?
Untethered only.
Just a broader question about all these units, Dean.
Yes.
How do they connect to the internet?
Right, so they all have different ways of connecting to the internet.
Okay, some Ethernet based?
Some Ethernet, which is my preferred option, hardwired. You can't beat a good old-fashioned wire.
So some are Ethernet and some are Wi-Fi, I presume?
Yes.
And I believe the Zappi is a combination of both?
No.
Oh, I believe, does it not transmit to the hub by a local radio signal?
A radio signal, not Wi-Fi. So it's not the 2.4 gigahertz yes. Wi-Fi signal.
So that's what I mean. So this will transmit from the Zappi unit to the hub by a radio frequency that's not Wi-Fi, and then that
which is
hub,
more reliable,
and that hub is then Ethernet.
Yes,
thank you. That's what I meant.
Okay. So,
but the rest are all. But some of them are Ethernet, some of them are mix.
Yeah. So, okay. These are Wi-Fi. This is Wi-Fi currently, but they're going for an Ethernet option. The EO Mini Pro is Ethernet. Tesla is linked via Wi-Fi. This is Wi-Fi and Ethernet.
Okay, so I presume if you've got the option of the two, Ethernet and Wi-Fi,
yeah.
I'm assuming from an install point of view, Ethernet's slightly dearer.
Yes. Obviously, you've got an Ethernet cable to run in there. It's a little bit more complicated, but if it were me, I'd pay the little extra and go with a more reliable Ethernet connection.
Okay, and I presume there's nothing stopping someone from buying a power over Ethernet box and plugging it in near where this unit is.
No, that's absolutely right.
One of the units that we haven't got here today is a PODPoint, which doesn't require an earth rod.
Looks very nice.
Probably one of the most seen units that you see around. Yep. Available untethered and tethered. Yep. Smart enabled again. There, it connects to the PODPoint app. So if you use Lidl, Charges, etc., you can actually use the same app that you use for that app to monitor your home usage. I believe on that one, it does use the SIM card inside the unit. Is that right?
That's right.
Installed, untethered.
About £550 for a PODPoint.
And tethered unit?
About £600. It's smart in terms of it meets the compliance regulations for the new smart charge points for OLEV. However, it's not quite as smart as my definition of smart, which for me would be that it has solar monitoring and charge scheduling. For some reason, it doesn't have charge scheduling yet. They may do in the future, but it's not as smart as it could be, and therefore, although it's slightly cheaper than things like the Zappi and the Emon, it will actually cost you more in the long run because it makes it harder to be convenient, to get convenient access.
Yes, so I'm presuming, unless if your car hasn't got a timer on it, or the timer for some of the cars, which we know are not the most reliable systems, you can't set a charge schedule for the Octopus Go tariff that gives you 5p electricity at night.
Exactly, which saves me about £350 a year per car.
Yes, and it saves me an absolute fortune. And if you are thinking of joining Octopus, there's a link down below in the description. You get £50 credit on your bill when you join Octopus Energy,
yep.
Which is a great start on the bill, but 5p electricity between 12:30 and 4:30 just means that charging your car is so much cheaper, and the standard rate for the electricity at the time of recording this video was 14p, which in the grand scheme of things is not that far off a regular standard rate of every other electricity.
The same
company.
As I was paying before with Empower, and yeah, you're also helping balance the grid and using power when it's clean and cheap.
So the next cheapest point is, I believe, the EO Pro, which is At the time of recording this video, not out, but the time I release it should be out. When's the release date due on the EO Pro?
In about a month.
About a month, so it should, yeah. So this video should be around about the time it's being released. So the EO Pro requires an earth rod, I believe.
It does. It requires an earth rod. It's quite smart. It's got a really good app. Charge scheduling features so that you can take advantage of things like the Octopus EVGO tariff, which saves you about £350 a year. It comes in a tethered and untethered option.
Does it do solar diversion, Dean?
No.
No. But you can monitor it. Can it work with the Octopus's API for the Octopus Go tariff?
Yes, and hopefully eventually the Agile tariff as well. So yeah, really great unit. Looks really neat. It's the smallest unit on the market as well, so if you want something that's really discreet and doesn't stand out like a sore thumb on the front of your house, this is the perfect one to go for.
So the next two cheapest units are the Zappi, which technically is the untethered, is the cheapest first, which is how much, Dean?
695.
And this tethered unit is 725.
That's right.
Both these units do not require an earth rod, which brings some extra sort of cost savings, mainly, me and Dean were talking before, all these units we've priced with exactly about one earth rod. Now, technically, you could need quite a few more than one earth rod.
You could, yeah, if you've got ground that's a bit dry and doesn't get a good earth.
What's the most amount of earth rod you've done on a job off the top of your head?
Four.
Four, and how much is each additional earth rod?
About £50.
Right, so this could actually, the cheapest pro version of this could actually very quickly become one of the dearest units.
It could.
Where these obviously have got the additional cost saving that they don't need
and
any earth
rods. Slight advantage is that it looks neater when you haven't got an extra earth rod, and sometimes it can be a little bit tricky and start involving builders' work to start lifting paving and things like that.
Okay.
If you need to put an install.
So how earth rod. I know roughly how the earth detection works on this, so do you want to, can you sum it down? Can you dumb it down for the rest of us on how it works?
Not really, because it's got a patent on it. It's all top secret.
Witchcraft.
Yeah, witchcraft.
Witchcraft.
But so ask Lee at My Energy about that. He's an absolute genius with electronic stuff, and they've come up with a fantastic way of not requiring an earth rod, which personally I think is a better, safer, and more reliable way to do it, especially for the Zoe people who...
Yes. So
Zoes are a bit fussy, as we know.
Yeah, so again with Dean, I agree that a non-earth rod solution, from a safety point of view, in my mind, is better. The reason I think that is, if you're putting an earth rod in the car, which is basically just a copper rod, essentially.
Yeah, yeah.
That could rot, could go, could get kicked out.
You need
the
to have it tested.
Yeah, you need to have it tested, maintained. And most people do not maintain their electrics in the house, never mind an earth rod that's stuck in the ground, where this... it outrules all that sort of maintenance side of an earth rod. The chance of the main distribution board's earth going is extremely rare, isn't it?
It is extremely rare. Happened very, very few times in this country. But the earth rod is the right solution, the safer solution in some scenarios.
So all these units, apart from a couple, are available in untethered and tethered units. If you're going for an untethered unit, that's my personal preference, mainly because of a neatness point of view and because of work, I take various cars home, like the Nissan Leaf, which is using a Type 1 and then a Type 2. But from now on, all cars in the EU will be Type 2 plugs. Forget Brexit. Right. But yes, they're all going to be...
The B word.
Yeah, they're all going to be Type 2 plugs from this point on. But Dean's preference is a tethered unit,
yep.
Which is very odd to hear from an installer, because most installers will recommend a non-tethered unit. Why is that, Dean?
Well... one of the highest risk items to fail on a unit, which is, you know, a daily wear and tear thing, is the cable itself. Although having said that, it's very rare that one actually fails unless someone's driven over it, which does happen, believe it or not. However, I would personally recommend tethered. The reason being, it's just like a petrol pump. You can unplug it, plug it in. It takes you about 5 seconds, as opposed to tethered, when it's raining, you've got kids, pets. You don't want to have to get your cable in and out of your car. What we often find is that people sometimes leave the Type 2 to Type 2 cable in the unit at home all the time and then drive out and then find they haven't got the cable in the car. So then they end up buying a second cable, which somewhat defeats the object. Although this does give you the extra flexibility, like Nick said, if you've got an early Nissan Leaf, Mitsubishi Fev or Vauxhall Ampera, that you can use either car on the untethered charge point. And it looks a bit neater too.
We've just instantly found out a possible development that's happening with the untethered version of My Energy.
Some actual news.
Yeah, some actual news, breaking news. Hopefully I would have released this before My Energy talk about it, which is even better. They are releasing a piece of software so you can lock the untethered cable into the non-tethered unit, which essentially gives you a tethered and non-tethered unit if
Correct.
You have both cars.
That's right.
Which would... now make that the most attractive charge point, because A, it's one of the cheapest to install, And two, it gives you the flexibility of using older cars. Dean, it does.
I still like my tethered. It's my favourite, sorry.
But yes, in my mind, this is now the clear winner for me on which charge point I'd go for. The next cheapest unit, and probably one of the best looking ones that we have on this display, but we're going to go into other better looking units in a minute, but probably the best one we've got display at the moment is this Webasto unit,
yep.
Which is only available in tethered unit.
It is, it's only available in tethered, German build quality, very nice looking unit. This one is just over £1,000 because it's not OLEV eligible. However, they do have a new one out. This is the Webasto Pure. The new one is the Webasto Live, which is a bit more expensive, even though it is OLEV eligible, because it's a very, very sophisticated unit.
I'm presuming that the old unit isn't OLEV eligible because it's not smart.
It doesn't comply with the smart regulations of OLEV.
Okay.
Which are different to my definition of smart, but that's another story.
Okay. But at the moment, this doesn't comply to OLEV. But they've got a new unit. Will, do we know roughly price on the new unit?
The new unit, after the OLEV grant, is about £1,200 installed. It's a very, very sophisticated unit. It's got all kind of smart apps features. It will do solar. They're looking at the earth rod solution, apps, charge scheduling, and all the...
And when's that due out?
It's just about now.
Now? Okay.
Yeah, that's about...
Out now.
Out now. Out now. About now-ish.
About now-ish.
Ish. Ish. Give or take.
The next unit is the Tesla unit. Now, you may recognise the Tesla unit because it's the same Tesla unit that you'll see in public charge points all across the country.
That's right.
The destination charges.
That's right.
I'm guessing on that then that these are all three-phase.
Yes, they're three-phase, although they obviously work on a single-phase if you use it in a domestic setting. Most people only have single-phase at home. The unit costs around £1,200 installed because it doesn't attract the OLEV grant, although I would imagine... And this is guessing what Elon's going to do, which is obviously a big guess. But at some point, with this being a Tesla wall charger, if you have Tesla solar roof, Tesla Powerwall, and a Tesla Model 3 or S or X or Y when it comes out, that at some point they will probably do a software update where they'll all talk to each other and you can use the app to control all kinds of features with your car. So this is probably fairly future-proof. It's a really nice-looking unit. It's only available in tethered. It's one of my favourites, and... Obviously, it's a bit more expensive than some of the others, but if you've got a Tesla Model 3 on order, this is certainly one to consider.
Yeah, I mean, the other one of the few pros that this actually does do...
This is one of my favourite little features.
Which is...
It's quite sad.
It's a built-in catch opener for your Tesla Model 3, so if you press that button, it will automatically open the power socket...
That's right.
...on your Tesla Model 3.
Press and hold the button, it opens the charge port.
And there's some Easter eggs that you can do only with this Tesla charge point.
Yes.
Which we're not going to go into today. We're going to demonstrate it one day, but not now. Spoke about the EO Mini, which is this one here.
Yep.
But EO also offer the Pro?
No. That's the Pro.
Sorry?
This is the Genius.
This is the Genius.
This is very sophisticated. Very good for home chargers where you want a bit more information. You can buy this with the hub as well. Ideally suited really to workplace.
So with the hub, does that mean it's OLEV approved?
Yes.
Do you need the hub to be OLEV approved?
Yes.
Yes. And how much does that come into with the hub then?
With the hub, you're probably looking at about £1,200. Very, very good build quality. Cast alloy housing, all stainless steel fixings. Available in tethered and untethered.
Now, obviously people in the camera...
Very nice looking unit as well.
People obviously watching this on film can't actually tell, but out of all the units, this is definitely the best. I mean, I'll just get my microphone near it. It feels the best out of all of them. The build quality on this, I'd say, is the highest.
Nice feel. It's a good unit.
Yeah. I've noticed a little barcode on the side.
Yes.
What's that for?
That is for when you're using it. These can be used as public charge points as well, or at workplace. So if you've got a lot of staff, 10 staff with all the electric cars, they download the app. This is compatible with the app as well for all sorts of features. They scan the QR code on the side. It's all very sophisticated. Or if you don't want to use your camera, you can enter the serial number of the unit and it will log how much electricity each individual member of staff has used. So that can be all sent across for their billing for the benefit in kind and tax, all the tax stuff that accountants need to do.
Okay, and if you're having these fitted for your house, for example.
Yes.
Could you also make this publicly accessible on PlugShare and then bill through an EO, got a central billing account there?
Yes, you could do that as well. Okay. And EO, we've also got a proper contactless payment system as well. So for public places, you can use up to four of these per station on a contactless payment system.
Okay. So if you are a house and you did have one of these fitted and your house is in a busy built-up area where you might want to offer your charging,
and you're an EV advocate, this would be ideal for you. One of the other units that we've not mentioned is the Anderson unit that also has Wi-Fi, and the new version has Wi-Fi and Ethernet as well.
Okay, nicely that you bring us onto that, because it's the only unit that we sadly haven't got here because Anderson weren't able to provide us a demo unit in time. So I will display a lovely picture and image of it.
Yep, very nice looking unit.
Yeah, out of all the units, apart from the EO one we had before, which was the stainless steel, I'd say the Anderson and obviously the Webasto unit are probably the best two looking. The Anderson's probably the best looking unit by far because you can't see the cables.
You can't see the cables. So it's the best of both worlds in terms of the most common gripe about tethered is that you see the cable. If you really want things to look clean and sharp, untethered is the way to go. However, Anderson have come up with a solution, so you've got the best of both worlds. So it's tethered, but the cable wraps up around the unit inside a little, there's a little sort of socket.
Yes, it kind of chafed in the inside, so the cable's hidden inside the unit.
A little gap all the way around, so you can wrap the cable around the unit and you can't see the cable, and then the plug neatly tucks up away inside under a little flap.
And that's all lit up as well at night.
Yeah, it's all illuminated. It looks really smart. You can have the unit either custom colour, sprayed in any colour you like. There are all the standard colours which should be displayed on here. You can also have things like timber finish on the product. Looks very, very nice.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen a couple of timber finishes on a brick building.
Yeah.
And from a distance, you can't even see there's a unit on the wall.
Yeah.
So it's one of the biggest units. But
yeah,
weirdly,
it's very large.
But weirdly, one of the most aesthetically pleasing units.
Blends in very nicely.
Yeah.
It's the sort of unit that you'd imagine your very sophisticated Porsche Taycan owner would have at the side of their car.
Yes. However, there is a caveat to the beautifulness of Anderson's. How much does the unit cost to be installed, Dean?
About £950 to £1,000.
Okay, so it's one of the most expensive
units. One of the more expensive ones. And there's quite a long lead time on manufacture, obviously, because they're usually built to order.
Okay, and regarding build quality, I believe quite good build quality.
It's up there.
Yeah.
Earth rods required, although they are working on a solution that will not need an earth rod or a lesser intrusive earth rod.
Right. Okay. But that's an Ethernet cable as well, isn't it?
It is now. Yes.
Okay. Yep. And out of all the units, do Anderson sort of dictate to you as an installer the way that unit's been installed? Because every time I've ever seen an Anderson unit, the cabling is always very well hidden.
They do have probably higher regulations than anyone else in terms of how it's fitted. We always use stainless steel fixings anyway, because especially if you're working on historic or listed buildings, that always helps. You're not putting ferrous fixings into the fabric of the building. It looks neater and you don't get horrible rust stains down your wall. And for, about an extra pound on the cost of some extra stainless steel screws, I believe that it's really important.
So unlike other installers, all your charge points that you install, you always use stainless steel fittings?
Yes, I've got a bit of a thing for stainless steel. Don't
right.
laugh.
So thank you very much for watching this week's video. Don't forget to click the subscribe button down below. Check out my other videos, and I'll see you again next week. Goodbye.